Okay. La 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 la.
Loot.
Yeah, it goes back
loot.
To now you're
Do you want me to keep it on? Loot.
It's this thing. Yeah.
Okay. So for the spotlight.
Yes. I thought it was really good. Again, I'm just going to give a big thank you to all those that helped prepare the food and all the servers that helped prepare the food. Thank you. Okay, can we get the teachers, the Sterling School teachers that have offered to help introduce the grads as they come out and present themselves to come up here and join me?
Restricted for friendships more her ability to have a positive influence on her peers. Alana has enjoyed lots of chances to travel in her young life, and this has influenced her future as well. After graduation and then serving on a mission, she has big plans. On top of attending Purely Inspired Hair Institute in the fall, Alana will be working towards her pilot's license. It won't be long before this young lady is flying herself around to new aspirations.
Matthew Davis. School at the end of his 8th grade year. During his time at student school, Matt participated in a range of extracurricular activities, including our computer games club, as well as our school plays. After graduation, Matt plans on moving to college and has the stated goal to one day beat Elon Musk in a game of chess. Jaden Edwards.
Attended Sterling School since kindergarten. At this time, he has no concrete plans for the fall. However, he does hope to one day attend university, maybe U of L, take business courses, and pursue an MBA. Some of his most memorable moments in his senior year are getting in trouble and nearly getting kicked out of the gym watching the high school girls team try and win provincials. And DePue asking him every day if he was going to play basketball for his senior year back. For his senior year. And he did. Oakley Hershey. A recent addition to our graduating class, Oakley has quickly become an important part of our school community. Following high school, Oakley plans to study political science at the University of Calgary. He also looks forward to future travel opportunities, including trips to Mexico to explore the Chihuahua region, as well as Japan, where he hopes to snowboard and witness the blooming of the cherry blossom trees. Oh, yeah.
The Bay Otter. The Bay has attended Sterling School for almost all of her school career. Was an integral part of our minor officials for 5 years. After graduation, DeVay plans to study criminology at Lethbridge College. Once she kicks the college's butt, DeVay plans to travel the world before moving to either the USA or Toronto to work as a crime scene investigator. Logan McMurray. Since grown into a tall, intelligent young man, Logan was involved in a computer games club and considers his participation in our school play, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, one of his great memories. After graduation, Logan plans on moving to Calgary to attend Visual College of Arts and Design to study 3D animation and modeling.
Parker Mickelson. Parker has been at Sterling School forever. After high school, Parker plans to serve a mission for his church and then find a town to be the tallest person in. Some of Parker's favorite memories from high school include playing high school basketball and Mr. Lutz's math classes. Apparently, they were wild. Finley Redden. Finley joined Sterling School in grade 8, and he has thrived every day since. After graduation, Finley will study computer science at the University of Lethbridge. After that, Finley hopes to do some multitasking and learn Mandarin while leading a conquest of Rome. Once Rome is conquered, he will declare himself as the successor of Rome and reclaim lost imperial territories.
Caden Seeley.
school, Hayden plans on serving a mission for the LDS Church sometime later this year. Upon returning, Hayden aspires to pursue a career in the medical field as some form of medical doctor. He's not sure what kind of doctor yet, but a doctor nonetheless. Perhaps someday we'll hear about Hayden in Doctors Without Borders, but Hayden may be so bold, maybe eat sports medicine to complement your resume. Bo Shock. After high school, Bo as well intends to serve a mission for the LDS Church this fall. Afterwards, Bo will pursue his future by attending BYU and entering the field of dentistry, specializing in pediatrics. But before Bo settles down that way, he would like to move to Hawaii and live homeless there, spending his days serving and hunting for food with a certain not-mentioned friend. His fondest high school memory is that of 109% that he got in math with Mr. Lowe.
That's some Stacey. Hudson joined his graduating class at Sterling School in grade 8. Once graduated, he plans to attend Lethbridge College, where he wants to study either mechanics or business. A few of the things that he'll always remember from his time at Sterling School are learning about Bitcoin from Mr. Stone and winning the Deep South Basketball League.
Canada, Good evening, graduates, parents, delegates, and guests. My name is Joey Luce, and I have had the privilege, you could say, of teaching most of these students for quite a few years now. When they asked me to speak at their graduation, they told me that they wanted to, and I quote, roast the ever-living crap out of us. I believe it was Parker who told me that, and I'll have much more on him later. As I sat down to write this speech, I realized that I had more content to some of these students than others. To the 9 students who were in my Math 30 classes this year, I apologize for what is about to happen. To those who weren't, I had to think back to our time together in junior high and reach out to other teachers to figure out what to say about you. Please remember, everything I'm about to say is said with love and respect for each of you, except for Parker. He sucks. Cruz Adamson. The last time I was in charge of Cruz's learning was in grade 9 PE. Cruz and P.E. do not get along, as he did not believe in changing into a gym strip. As I look back, I guess it makes sense that he wouldn't want to get changed, because if he was wearing shorts and a t-shirt, how could he show off all of his cool new clothes, or his new shoes, or new phone, or new earring, or whatever else he had going on that day? Even today, if you were to check the back of Cruz's phone, I believe he has a Pokemon card in there with dollars. Why anyone ever needs a $300 piece of laminated cardboard is beyond me, but what do I know? Mr. Brett Braun. Brett is a recent addition to our school and has been fairly quiet throughout his time here. In fact, he has been so quiet that one of his teachers has labeled him the quiet genius. He earned this title due to his ability to sit silently and nearly motionless during class, apparently not doing much at all, and then ends up doing very well on his tests, which is super cool. Brett, we are happy to have you with us here this year, and we wish you the very best in the future. You know who we don't wish the very best to? Parker, he sucks. Emily Clapton. These are the first words I have ever spoken to Emily in my life. And you know what? That's a problem. But it's not a me problem, it's a her problem. Like, who doesn't seek out Mr. Lutz in their day to have a chat? Lame people, that's who. In my investigation about the elusive Emily, I have learned that she is a huge fan of horses, perhaps a real equine enthusiast. And this is maybe another reason why we haven't talked before today, as horses creep me right in the yard. Mr. Liam Cook. Liam has almost become a ghost story to me since grade 10. Is his name still around? Is he working? Is he gonna finish? Is he still wearing his hat? Yes. Good afternoon. Good job. Alana Cutler. Alana rejoined us in grade 11 after a little bit of a hiatus.
campus knew that we had another girl in this class. And not just any girl, a girl with personality and a sense of humor that could keep up with this gaggle of goofballs. Through Math 3-1, I've got to know Alana quite well. She can sing and dance and works very hard to make sure she understands everything she can in class. What she is not good at is keeping her joints healthy. I swear she has her knees or ankles wrapped more often than not when she's at school. Perhaps one day she'll learn how to walk and dance as gracefully as she sang O Canada 2 minutes ago. Mr. Matthew Davis. I have not had as many opportunities to get to know Matthew as I have some of his classmates. But from the times I have talked to him, I have found Matthew to have a great sense of humor and an excellent sense of responsibility that he put on full display when he worked at the minor official table through most of his high school career. I believe that Matthew will find a great path in his life and enjoy his journey along the way. Good luck, sir. Mr. Perm, Jay Lambert. I think that Jade may have some of the best interpersonal skills among this entire group. He is able to pick up on cues from those around him and talk to them on their level whenever he wants to. This is generally great. However, Jade likes to use his powers for evil. I can't even remember the number of times I was trying to teach a math lesson, and Jade would bring up something to do with the latest Star Wars series on Disney Plus, or the gym, or something else, and I would get so distracted that I couldn't even teach. I truly think that Jaden kept a timer each time he did that, just to see how long he could keep it going. I did get the better of him in the end, though. Earlier this year, when we were talking about how many sisters I have, he was curious if any of them were single. He found out that one of my sisters is 21 and single, and decided that he wanted to bring her with him as his grad date. He even went to the trouble of sliding into her DMs to ask her to come. I'm happy to say that my sister is a smart young lady and told Jake to do that. And now he owes me $20. Oakley Hershey. Oakley hasn't been with us that long, and there was a time when we thought he would leave us again, but I think we are all happy to see that he decided to finish his high school career here in Sterling. At the start of the year, we were unsure if Oakley was going to be able to make it here today, but he showed that he has some true grit when he needs to get things done, and rocked his final semester at high school. The day I knew Oakley was going to make it was the day I showed up to school, and he was already hard at work in the weight room before classes even started. In the fall, we couldn't even get him to be on campus for more than an hour, and now he's showing up ready to work out. That doesn't happen very often, and I think that's really cool. Excellent work, Oakley. Navee Hawthorne. I got to know Navee pretty well through many hours sitting at the sport table for both basketball and volleyball over the past 5 years. Navee is another great female presence in this class, as she does not put up with any crap from anybody. She has a clear sense of what is right and wrong and will not hesitate to express her opinion, even to people who may not be quite ready for what her opinion is. Frankly, I'm hesitant to say anything mean about Navee, as she might just get up on her chair, grab a fork, and chase me around the school. I was very happy when Navee came back to us in November, and this day really wouldn't be the same if she wasn't sitting there with us. Logan McMurray. Logan, you're a very bright young man with all the potential to do whatever you want to do in this world. There was a time when I was unsure if you'd see Logan here today, but seeing him there makes me really, really happy. And I know I'm not the only one who is. You did it, buddy. Now get out there, go find something that tickles your fancy, and crush it. Parker. Earlier this morning, Parker and I had a little chat about this speech, and he told me a story that pretty much sums up why Parker is who he is. Now picture this. Parker is getting ready to have a shower. Oh, wait, don't picture that. Don't picture that. Anyway, as he prepares to shower, he needed to plug his phone in. So he takes the cord from the wall, plugs it into his phone like any other day, as you do, and then tries to get in the shower. And what happens next is pretty cool. He goes to step in the shower, trips over the cord, bashes his head against the wall, and his phone flies in the toilet. He then spends the next 10 minutes with a blow dryer, sitting on the toilet and trying to dry his phone. And only Parker can do that. Now, I have been told that ladies love a tall, dark, and handsome man. Unfortunately for Parker, he only meets one of those criteria. Parker has had some struggles with the ladies this year, and I'd like like to give you my version of how his love life has unfolded. I think at one point he had a girlfriend, but she probably dumped him because he drinks too much Mountain Dew. Then I gather he had one date lined up with Rad, but she turned him down when she realized that his teenage Tinder profile was heavily exaggerated. Changing tactics, Parker found a second date for Rad after being set up by his best friend, Jamie. The second girl lasted much longer than the first. She did not run away when he went to pick her up for an ice cream date. She let him buy her ice cream first, and then she tucked it all around. At this point, other young men would have felt defeated and just settled for coming to Grad alone, but not our Parker. He went out there and found yet a third date for Grad, and this one stuck. I'm not quite sure why, what he did to get her to agree to come with him, and I do know that he forgot to buy her a ticket for dinner until this morning. By the way. But this confirms one thing about our beloved partner. He is a scrappy fellow who will not give up a chance to create funny stories for us to hear about. Love you, Parker. Finley Rudder. I personally believe that Finley is one of our great success stories here at Sterling School. When he showed up in grade 8, he was super quiet, wouldn't really talk to anyone, and was clearly very apprehensive about any game involving throwing balls in PE. 5 years later, not only is Finley talking to everybody, he's cracking jokes in class. One of his best jokes came during a radical functions lesson in Math 30, which all four of you better laugh at this. And it was, he's sitting there all quiet, doing his Finley thing, and suddenly looks up and sings, "Old MacDonald had a cat, and he had a dog." And while that may not sound super funny right now, I promise you that he was beside himself with laughter for a solid 5 minutes, and we got nothing else done that entire class. Finley has also shown that he has some sneaky talents. He has his own website, where he has posted some of his own music, and I must say that it's actually pretty good. He also has aspirations of conquering the world, as we talked about earlier. So I guess the introvert we once knew has all but disappeared. He's now a gorgeous swan, ready to tackle the world and make Rome his personal plaything. Caden Seeley. I honestly struggled to think of something to say about him. Even when I asked other kids about what I could say to post him, they all said what I believe to be true. Caden is too nice of a kid to be really mean to. He's a great wrestler, has been a staple of our minor officials group forever, and has always tried his best in class, even when Parker and Jamie were off beating their silly selves. Thankfully, Caden himself reminded me of a funny story this morning. In PE 30 last semester, during our archery event, Caden decided it would be a good idea to try and lob an arrow into a target. So, to set the stage, Caden was standing about where the shopping table is, with a big bouquet of flowers there. There was targets about here, a big net behind the targets, and then the walls there. So that's the stage. So to do this, to try and lob an arrow in the target, he drew his bow halfway, pointed it at the ceiling, and let it go. Unfortunately for Caden, his knowledge of physics is not so good. And upon release, the arrow soared over the archery target, over the mat, and embedded itself 3 inches to the left of the L in that wall over there. Don't ask me where I was. I was watching very closely. Other than being bad at physics, the only other thing I can think of is that when I came to watch the play, Caden made it the most uncomfortable experience for me ever. Through one of the dancing scenes, Caden decided it would be a good idea to lock eyes with me the entire time as I was sitting in the bleachers. The entire time he was dancing, he did not blink or turn his head away from me at all. He stared me dead in the eyes. And I was very comfortable. So while Caden is a really nice kid, I guess he's also a creepy dude who we should all go away once he graduates. Bo Shaw. Sometimes I honestly believe that Bo lives in an alternate reality. A parallel universe where he sees things happen that just aren't true in our world. For example, he says I flexed one day and is actually more defined than mine. If I really flexed, he'd be so humble that he would never talk again in my class. And trust me, he talked a lot in my class. He also says he beat me in an arm wrestle and made me eat a pretzel. Bo, you know, I do not believe in pretzels. And you beat me in an arm wrestle? No. On a positive note, Beau was the person who introduced me to Scotch Caps. They're a yummy bun that we had in our peanut butter and jam day in 9:30. And I guess he has some of you colleagues. Hudson stays again. Hudson is like a fine bottle of wine. And like a fine bottle of wine, Hudson needed time to age and flourish into the tasty human being you see over there today. I remember times during math class in grades 10 and 11 where I was frustrated with Hudson. He'd come in slowly, saunter about, appeared to be in La La Land all class long, and was more concerned with looking at shoes online than doing his assignments. Then, suddenly, grade 12, or Kenzie Holmes, happened, and Hudson turned into a new man, ready to learn and determined to find success in his grade 12 year. I really enjoyed Hudson during my 3rd-2, honestly, I really did. We had some great laughs, and they really did show that he committed to something when he wants to. I also had a great time watching Hudson on the basketball court, and more importantly, watching Hudson go wild while he was cheering for his teammates on the court, or when a play or a call was made, he just did not agree with it. We also had a good time together when reffing our junior high basketball games and getting yelled at. And Hudson, I have to say, you're definitely a goofball, but I've seen you mature into a young man who I think will find success wherever you put your mind to it. That'll work. Kasaya is an interesting person. Before she left us in junior high, she was always super loud in class and ready to pick a fight with anyone in there, no matter what was going on. When she left, we thought the class would calm down a bit, but it turns out that Kasaya was actually a bit more of a moderator than an instigator in the group. When we found out she was coming back this year, her teachers were all quite excited. She's a bright young lady who contributes to both her intellect and her, shall we say, unique sense of humor to class conversations. Kasaya has shown that she is able to make some pretty good decisions. Examples include when she chose to come back to Sterling to finish her high school career, and how she continually ripped on Parker during math class for his constant leap of humor. She has also shown that she can make some silly decisions, though. Like making sure Hudson her shoulder buddy for most of her classes. He's not single anymore, Kasaya. Kenzie works out, and she will throttle you if she feels the need. Reese Walters. I struggled to come up with something to say about Reese. On one hand, he's a valedictorian, was an integral part of winning our first ever wrestling provincial banner, did well, got bronze in track and field yesterday at Zones, and provided the toaster and peanut butter for our peanut butter and jam day in math class. On the other hand, he was the most frustrating student I've ever taught. He refuses to write stuff down in class, will often be outside gallivanting with 7-year-olds while he's supposed to be doing math, And instead of learning becoming a doctor or something, he has aspirations of being homeless in Hawaii with Beau after he serves a mission. I guess you could say that makes him kind of like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get until they walk through that door. And I guess we love him for that too. In all seriousness, this class is a rare breed. As teachers, we often have conversations about the different classes in the school. Which classes are challenging, which classes are full of potential astronauts, and for this class, we always come back to the point that they are just a great group of kids to have conversations with. It's just easy to talk to all of them. They definitely enjoy conversations that have nothing to do with the learning meant to take place in class, but they also have an uncanny ability to look at real-life situations and provide their opinions if they're actually adults. I know for sure that I will miss the casual conversations I have had with this group, and I'm positive that the other teachers feel the same way. To the grads, good luck in your last month at high school. Please show up to school as close to on time as you can, and we'll all get along swimmingly. Now, I believe Parker and Jane are up next, and I would just like to say that whatever they have to say about me is a lie. Thank you, everybody, and cheers to graduating class in 2022.
Good evening, everyone. For those of you who don't know me, I am Parker Wilson, and I'm Jay Williams. We are up here tonight on behalf of the graduating class to collectively thank our parents for all they have done to get us to this moment. We'd like to start our speech up straightforward. We owe a large thank you to all the parents who have raised us in the last 18 years of our lives. Some, even though
most of us are the most academically inclined. We all made it to graduation, so we owe every single parent thank you. You know, when you think about it, your parents sure got really lucky with the whole COVID thing. All that spirit was so much fun. Because who wouldn't love to be stuck at home with moody teenagers all day, every day for months? But hey, we all made it to graduation, so that's something right.
And we passed most of our classes, so I would think we did pretty good. Lutz once said, and I quote, "Go grab your textbook and drop chemistry while you're at it." That may be the only time I ever actually listened to it. He also told us that education is important, but biceps are importanter. So you can probably tell Mike's a math teacher, and you can see which one of us listened to.
Me and Parker, we had a pretty good run of this high school thing in the last couple of years. You know, we were varsity basketball captains, self-proclaimed student council presidents, and surprisingly, neither of us got suspended. This would be impressive at any other school that had more than 17 graduating students. Even though a good portion of our high school was spent online, I think our parents helped us get through high school in one piece. The constant reminder is that we were, in fact, still in high school in the middle of March, and it wasn't an early summer break.
Next, we would like to thank all those involved with our basketball season, especially those who helped us with the making of our senior night. Along with this, we would like to thank all those who helped with every school activity we had, including other sporting events, concessions, school play, student council activities, and all the other things that it helps make happen for us. We know it was a lot of work, and we really appreciate the time and effort that was put into all of it.
Lastly, we'd like to thank all the teachers for organizing.
Except for Lutz. He did bare minimum.
Typical, right?
In his defense, that's what he did for trusting a gym teacher's responsibility.
In all seriousness, though, we owe all the parents and adults in our lives a huge debt of gratitude for everything you've done for us, for the time you've taken to make our high school experience as normal as we possibly can. And for that, we say thank you.
And thank you all for joining us here tonight. We love and appreciate you.
Face in the clouds, found face in the storm. That was awesome. It's really fun to see these kids as they grow up. So moving on now, we're going to hit the
valedictorian, Mr. Reese Walters. And following his address, we'll hear from Ms. Katie White. So, Reese, it's yours.
We tend to improve a lot of want to know how we are, how we get that happening. We surround ourselves with positive people, positive experiences, and it's the secret to creating a better life for yourself. So on that note, I'd like to end my speech by saying thank you to the wonderful teachers we have at the school for how patiently they've been helping us. We couldn't have made it to graduation without you. I'd like to thank our parents who helped us every step of the way. And for the foundation they gave us, we can make it here tonight. And I'd like to thank you, my fellow graduates, for making this an amazing high school experience and what I want to remember for the rest of my life. It's now my privilege to introduce our guest speaker for the evening. Not in room with us, she's sent us a video of her speech. So I'd like to introduce Miss Katie White. She's a young adult writer, wife, mother of four, and the 10th of 13 children. She grew up in Sterling, to be a philosophy of European university. A lover of travel, speaking and access, experiencing new cultures. She's traveled extensively. Studied in Israel, lived in Brazil, and now in Boston, Arizona. For 7 years, Katie worked as a senior director for a Fortune 500 company and was one of the faces of the national university. Shortly following the birth of her first child, she chose to stay home full time and focus on her family and her writing. My name is Katie Watson. She's the author of four young adult novels, including Seeking Mansfield, a forward in the use of convention, and off-script in 2020 Junior Library of Selection. Passionate adoption advocate, she's also a contributor to Eric Smith's work on adoption and anthology. Ladies and gentlemen, Katie Bateman.
Challenges. call me after finishing it, I asked. So, how did you like it? He paused. For those of you keeping track at home, pauses are bad. Then he said it was good, it was well written, but it was hard to read. Why did such bad things have to happen to him? Now, my dad is a voracious reader, even beyond the hard people books. He knows how stories work. What he was really saying was that he wanted the character to have a happier journey because he liked him. But I have learned my lesson. Thanks to my dad, the path of least resistance doesn't work in real life, and it definitely doesn't work in literature. I'd like you to think for a moment about your favorite book or movie. Think about the protagonist, the hero's journey. Is it smooth sailing? Is everything easy for your character? Does she get everything she wants with no difficulty? No, of course not. Can you imagine reading Harry Potter if he was born a kick-butt wizard? If his aunt and uncle were super nice and supportive, if everyone in school was good to him, and if the first time he took on Voldemort, he had vodka down from the dude into oblivion, horcruxes and all? No. How about Tony Stark? If he hadn't suffered through Obadiah Stone, Ivan Vanko, Aldrich Killian, Loki, and Ultron, could he have had the strength to defeat Thanos? Not even slightly. Without adversity, a character cannot grow. Without challenges, a character has no need to change. Without trying and failing, and then trying again, characters cannot become someone they're rooting for, and cannot learn the lessons they need to become the hero. As Camille N. Johnson said, trials are the elements of the plot that make our favorite stories compelling, timeless, and worthy of telling. Yet we shrink from challenges, don't we? We want our own path to be easy, to be smooth sailing. Why do we want less for ourselves than we want for our favorite characters? Whether you want them or not, you will all have trials. You will want a job that you don't get. You will have a hard class or training that might derail you. Someone you love will break your heart. You will be denied something or someone that you desperately, heart-wrenchingly long for. You will work on a project with your whole soul, and it will come to nothing. Lean into the suffering. Learn from the suffering. I started working on a book in 2006 during a really challenging time in my life. Writing this book became my solace. To this day, it's probably my favorite thing I've ever written. I spent thousands of hours researching everything I could about how to write a novel, how to plot, how to pace, how to characterize. I learned about tropes and how to play with reader expectations. I studied emotional beats. I joined a writing group and went to meetings with other aspiring authors. I wrote on nights and weekends and at every spare moment. And I poured everything I learned into this book, which became two, which became three. I wrote about 300,000 words of a young adult, world-hopping, portal fantasy trilogy over the course of the next 5 years. Next, I had friends, family, and strangers on the internet read it to give me feedback. I revised it a dozen times. I entered it into contests and incorporated that feedback from industry professionals. Over the next year, I sent query letters to 100 agents and got 100 rejections. And just as I was working on revising it yet again, I read an interview with the top editors and publishers in the business. The interviewer asked these experts what book trends were dead. There was a universal agreement that of all the trends they were six to see, portal fantasy topped the list. It was a non-starter. I had spent 6 years of my life writing a series that no publisher was even willing to look at. Ouch. I had a choice to make. I can throw it all away, quit writing entirely, and just chop the whole thing up to a waste of time. Or I can press on. I had just spent 6 years writing about a character who overcame everything two worlds could throw at her, and honestly, I had to channel her a bit to not become discouraged. But during those years, I hadn't just learned the mechanics of writing. I learned what makes a character compelling, how she responds to adversity. I learned the difference between a trial that defines a character and a trial that derails one. The former makes you the protagonist, the main character, the hero. The latter makes you dispensable. In other words, how you handle adversity determines whether or not you're a secondary character in someone else's story or the hero of your own. Without those years of effort, I never would have learned the lessons I needed to learn to write the next book, the book that got me money, my agent, this time after a total of zero rejections. The book that got me a publisher and audiobook rights and foreign book rights. Without those years of effort, I wouldn't have pushed myself to try new things, to write outside of my comfort zone. Without those years of effort, I wouldn't have had the stomach to handle when my publisher suddenly went out of business months before my book was supposed to come out. I may have quit writing altogether then. If I had done so, I would have missed out on the greater opportunities that came when a bigger publisher bought out that press and published my book to a wider audience than the old publisher ever could have. Without those years of effort, I wouldn't be where I am now. Pressure and pain suck. There's no way around it, but they're essential for your growth. When trials hit you, and they will, choose to lean into them instead of away, and you'll find that each challenge will get you closer to the person you want to be. Each challenge will help you level up as the hero of your own story. All of you are about to embark on the next stage of your life. People will talk about this as the start of your journey, but we all know that's incorrect. The first 18 years of your life weren't prologue, they were chapters. And when you get your diploma and move on, you'll start a new chapter. In the story of your life, if it isn't yet clear if you're the hero or a disposable character, lean into the trials that come your way. If you're constantly coming in second place in the funkiest stress contest of your life, lean in and level up. If you're not sure what path you should take in your story, that's okay. Lean into the fear instead of running away from it. If in your story you really wish there was a whole chapter about you just spending a month in Hawaii, take a much-needed nap. And then wake up and get back to work. Becoming the hero is never easy, but it's always worth it. The hours and years and days you put into something, learning, practicing, failing, and trying again, will pay off. You just have to keep. So tonight, graduates of the 2022 class of Sterling High School, remember that a certain darkness truly is required to see the stars. But in that darkness is beauty, discovery, growth, heroism. No matter how your story ends, finding the stars in the darkness will help you become the kind of compelling main character that someone someday will want to write about. Maybe that someone will even be you. Congratulations, graduates. Enjoy your next chapter.
That was really good. Thank you, Reese, and thank you, Miss White. We're going to move on to you grads receiving your diplomas. So if I could please invite Mr. Mazatinek, Mr. Grant Hunter, Ms. Charitamira, and Mr. Shoffman to come and join me out here. I'll then proceed by calling each of you by name, and you come up here, make sure you come up and, shake hands with these people, and make sure you pose for your picture. All right, to get things going, let's start off. Cruz Adamson. Brett Brown. Emily Clapton. Liam Cook. Alana Cutler. Matthew Davis. Yeah.
Jaden Edwards. Hudson Stasiak. And lastly, Reese Walters.
Thanks, you guys.
Graduates,
to give a final thank you to all the people who helped make this night happen. First, we would like to recognize Ms. Wailongi. This all would not have been possible without her and all of the parental and student volunteers working tirelessly to transform this gym. Next, we would like to say a brief thank you to the parents, the ones that got us through high school, and also the ones that helped prepare the meal. We would also like to thank Angie Nelson and everyone who helped prepare and serve this fantastic meal. We are all grateful for the time you put in. Another thank you to Ms. Silito and Mrs. Anderson for putting time into designing our invitations and our program. We'd also like to give a big thank you to Mr. Lutz and all of the teachers who gave us our introductions. We would also like to thank all the teachers who believed in us and pushed us to our full potential throughout the years. Without all your efforts, we wouldn't have walked the stage tonight. Thank you to our guest speaker, Ms. Katie White, for taking time to put together a little something to say for us, as well as a shout-out thank you to Mr. Pugh for being our MC tonight, and Mr. Arwasa for his work on the slideshow. And lastly, we'd like to thank Mr. Shockley for taking time and putting up with us, and helping us figure out all the details for tonight. None of this would have been possible without him. And we are sad that Ms. Platt couldn't be here tonight, but we would also like to thank her for everything that she has done for us. Thank you again to everyone involved in the celebratory night. We greatly appreciate the attendance and everyone who helped, not only for graduation, but all you've done to get us this far. If we have forgotten anyone, we hope you know we appreciate you and all the work you've done. And thank you to the audience for being here with us to share this momentous occasion.
Hello. Thanks, Paul. Okay, so before we draw to a close here tonight, we do have a short message to relay from Ms. Pott to the graduates. She's currently on leave and 8 hours ahead of us in the Netherlands. So knowing our ceremony would take place during the wee hours of her morning, she prepared a short video for our grads. So Mr. Iwas is going to hit play and we'll hear a few very short words from her.
Graduates, parents, guardians, staff, ladies and gentlemen, I apologize for not being there in person this year, but that does not mean that I'm not there in spirit and with a message for these grads. As I am approximately 7,800 kilometers away from you on the other side of the world, there are similarities and differences. Some differences are language, some cultural etiquettes, like in my family, kissing someone on their cheek, alternating from side to side 3 times when greeting them or when leaving. When answering the phone, you always say your name. Using a knife and fork during dinner and not switching hands. Some similarities are things like driving on the right side of the road. There are 100 cents in each euro, just like 100 cents in our Canadian dollar. As I look up at the sky sitting on the deck of my mom's apartment, I see blue sky with clouds. Yet when I walk out at night, I see stars. Like your quote states, a certain darkness is needed to see the stars. Life over your high school career has been like the darkness. However, I do hope there was some light, like your teachers, your classmates, your athletic opportunities, the musical, Christmas bingo, Easter hunt, and various other events that we try to do. Through these years, I hope that you have learned that after the darkness, there is light, hope, opportunities, mountains to be climbed, countries to be explored, careers to be conquered. You have survived this part of your journey. You will be able to do anything that you put your mind to. Good luck, grads, and congratulations.
So this marks the end of our formal program for the evening. On behalf of the entire staff of Sterling School, I would like to thank you all for being here tonight to celebrate these great kids. Graduates, I hope you have a truly enjoyable evening with your friends and family. But above all, please be safe and make good choices. As Mr. Masters to say, we want to see the whites of your eyes come Monday morning, bright and early. At this point, I'd like to invite everyone with dancing shoes on to make your way over to the theater, where Mr. Ibarra has generously offered to be tonight's DJ. Our dance will be in the theater. And graduates, just as you make your way home tonight, please take your centerpieces with you or send them with your family. Thank you, everyone. Please enjoy the dance and the rest of the evening.